In those days, the multitude being very great and having nothing to eat, Jesus called his disciples unto him and saith unto them, I have compassion on the multitude because they have now been with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. And if I send them away fasting to their own houses, they will faint by the way. For diverse of them came from far. And his disciples answered him, From whence can a man satisfy these men with bread here in the wilderness? And he asked them, How many loaves have ye? And they said, 7. And he commanded the people to sit down on the ground, and he took the 7 loaves and gave thanks and brake and gave to the disciples to set before them, and they did eat them before the people. Or excuse me, they did set them before the people. They didn't eat them before the people. In verse 7, and they had a few small fishes, and he blessed and commanded to set them also before them. So they did eat and were filled, and they took up the broken meat that was left, 7 baskets. And they that had eaten were about 4,000, and he sent them away. This is the word of the Lord, and he will most certainly add his abundant and gracious and magnified blessing to the reading of this is holy truth. Let us seek the Lord's blessing that we might understand the portions that he's given us today. Most blessed and gracious Heavenly Father, in the name of your beloved Son, we do come before you. Thou art our Father and our God, and here you have brought us the bread of life, thy word, and the bread from heaven, the bread of life, thy Son, and feed us and nurture us and bring us nutrition for strength through the bread of life, thy Holy Spirit. And we pray, Father, that in that threefold blessing of the bread that you multiply, as we read in the text, as you've multiplied it unto those whom Christ had compassion on, and as Brother Gene prayed today in our opening prayer, that as we confidently and boldly come before the throne of grace in Jesus' name, that we might find mercy in time of need. And our need is that thou would have compassion upon us to illuminate the scriptures for us, that we may glorify you, exalt thy Son, Jesus Christ, and be edified, sanctified, and the people of God as a witness until Jesus comes again. In his name we do pray. Amen. Mark Chapter 8. I didn't change it into a topical, although it's my liberty to be able to do so, and I know that it would be a blessing for you to do something like that. But as I thought of what this particular day is, as Father's Day, what better blessing for the fathers of this congregation or any congregation, what better blessing for the husbands of the wives of this congregation than to receive the gospel message? And Mark 8 is a turning point in the Gospel of Mark, a blessed truth of the Gospel that is taking up, and as you see from your notes, we're going to go through the 38 verses, but we're going to have very broad strokes in painting the picture of what's going on, rather than getting at the nitty-gritty, because here again, they're breaking bread and for feeding multitudes, and often there's given a lot of emphasis there. The last time when they broke 5 loaves and 2 fishes, we kind of scurried through there as well. And it's all right to spend time on that, but if we miss the big picture, then spending time on it won't do us much good. We need to see the gospel in all its glory, and this lends certain truths that we see in it. We understand that the gospel of Matthew is given so that as the King of the Jews has come, the Christ of God, that we can fall to our knees to worship him and be in submission to him because he's king and worthy of all glory. And in Mark we see Jesus is presented as the suffering servant as an example, and that the gospel is given so that we as ministers of the gospel may go into ministry, may serve God and to serve others because we are in submission to our king. Just as Jesus has submission to his heavenly Father. So what a blessed Father's Day message it is to be in the Gospel of Mark for one who is a servant of God and in submission to God the Father immediately, taking action in all things. And though, interestingly, though the gospel is so prevalent in here, there, it is one gospel account that is the not only the shortest, but it gives less time to the Lord's actual preaching in order to present the overall for the gospel that's contained within who He is and what He does. That is an amazing account. Often it says that Jesus goes to preach, and it emphasizes His preaching, as we know that because faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And that bread of life that is broken unto the multitudes is an example unto us. As we read verses 1 through 9, we'll continue to move on here. I'll just break down where we're going with it. In chapter 8, we see the design of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. This is pivotal in the gospel account, because there's 16 chapters, and right here we're going to come to some truths and a turning point. It's a turning point in the Lord's ministry, because up until this point, He was teaching all those things of who He is so that they may be prepared for His teaching of what He's about to do, which is to go to the cross. And so we have the design of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and this is the presentation of Christ's propitiation and gospel fulfillment. And we'll see it in each one of these episodes put together. We have this broken up into two places. It's a two-point message. First, it's the first half of the chapter is beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of Herod. And we take that from verse 15 as being key to this portion. And then the second part is behold the cross of Jesus Christ. In the first part, we have the sin of religiosity, also the sight of the redeemed. And then in the second part, in behold the cross of Jesus Christ, we'll discover who Jesus is, what Jesus will do or has done, and how men must respond. So let's move right into it. As we read verses 1 through 9, let's read again this entire episode until verse 21. So they were feeding about 4,000, and they sent them away. In verse 10 it says, and straightway he entered into a ship with his disciples and came into the parts of Dalmanutha. And the Pharisees came forth, in verse 11, and began to question with him, seeking of him a sign from heaven, tempting him. And he sighed deeply in his spirit and saith, why doth this generation seek after a sign? Verily I say unto you, there shall no sign be given unto this generation. And he left them, and entering into the ship again, departed to the other side. Verse 14, now the disciples had forgotten to take bread, neither had they in the ship with them more than one loaf. And he charged them, saying, take heed, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, and the leaven of the leaven of Herod. He adds that in here, as it's not mentioned, and the leaven of Herod in Matthew's account when they cover this same episode. Verse 16, and they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because we have no bread. And when Jesus knew it, he saith unto them, why reason you because you have no bread? Perceive ye not yet, neither understand, have you your heart yet hardened? Having eyes, do you not see? Having ears, hear ye not? And do you not remember when I break the five loaves among 5,000, how many baskets full of fragments took ye up? And they say unto him, 12. And when the seven among 4,000, how many baskets full of fragments took ye up? And they said, 7. And he said unto them, how is it that you do not understand? They missed the point, as often even we preachers do, because there are great lessons within that which Jesus does and has compassion on a multitude. And certainly God, who condescends to become a man, has compassion upon fallen mankind to become a man, to be born as a babe, to put up with being in this world surrounded by sin and all His righteousness. And as we sang in that hymn, I cannot tell why He, the King of Glory, would leave the peace of all eternity. It's just far beyond us. And He does that. He has compassion. And He has it on a practical level, but there's so many soup kitchens and bread lines that are given over in the name of Christ and for the ministry, and they forsake the gospel as a result of it. Incredible. They bring these food lines and bread lines and soup lines in order to try to preach the gospel unto them, and they feed these masses But then they start putting the Bibles over off to the side and the gospel tracts away. And then the next thing they know, it's basically the Lions Club or the Rotarians. It has nothing to do with the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's because this is not what Jesus was doing. We could see that. He told them, there's a lesson for you. In John chapter 6, remember that he told us outright at the beginning of the very same episode that we saw earlier in Mark with the feeding of the 5,000 men, plus women and children, about 15,000 people, with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Philip was coming up to him, and Jesus asked Philip, where are we going to get bread to feed so many? But it says in the commentary, in the early part of it, I think it's in verse 6, that Jesus knew what he was going to do. He said it to test Philip. Because the point was not in the feeding of them. That was a practical thing that Jesus deals with details. And he didn't want them feeding on the way. But greater than that is the spiritual episode that went to teach his disciples, because he was teaching them all along, because the gospel would be carried on that Pentecostal day when the Holy Spirit falls upon Peter and the 11 and then the 120 that were there and gathered, and they would preach the gospel in that Temple Mount, and 3,000 would be added unto God. The miracle of bread being multiplied by the Holy Spirit, the bread of life, the Jesus Christ, the bread of life, as He is preached. And the Word of God proclaimed the bread of life, that men may be fed. What must we do to be saved? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Repent and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, is what Peter told them, right? That bread, that's the thing. See, what Jesus was pointing to was the sins of hypocrisy and pretense, which is pride. Here, as he said, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. In fact, the episode of feeding those, as far as for the disciples, giving them bread, and we could go into details on this, but we're not going to. We have to move on to see the gospel overall and really enjoy that. And there are some things that tie into this. But he uses those episodes in order to teach his disciples of the hypocrisy. He says, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. And he knew that off the heels of such a miracle, that they lacked understanding. We read in the Gospel of Mark how when he told them parables, that he told them parables so that others wouldn't understand, but that they would understand, so that they would ask, Lord, what did you mean by this? And he would tell them spiritual truths. And he didn't bring them parables, it said in the Gospel of Mark, and that was in chapter 4. He says, in chapter 4, he says, and with many such parables spake he the word unto them as they were able to hear it. So he brought them along as they grew. But we see in this episode in Mark chapter 8, that even though Jesus earlier fed the multitudes of 5,000 with 5 fish and 2 loaves, these guys were wondering, where can we get bread? O ye of little faith is right. I mean, don't you remember that he had done this before? You don't think he could do it again? I mean, he walked on water. Come on. And so here with this 7 loaves for 4,000. Well, that's an easier trick. I apologize to downplay it that much. But see, that was the thing, is that we get on to that. I think that even in the episode in all the Gospels where it presents the 5 loaves with 2 fish for 5,000 and then 7 loaves with 2 fish for 4,000 was to not get on the act of multiplying the bread. Christ can do that. He created the heavens and the earth. To look at the truth of the gospel that comes forth from this, because the leaven that rises, makes bread rise up as it corrupts the fine flour, as a picture of sin. Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. And so we see the hypocrisy and the pretense, which is the pride that was shown in the in an account just earlier of last week in Mark chapter 7. Remember that Jesus called them. Well hath Isaiah Well hath Esaias prophesied of you hypocrites, as it is written, the people honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. And Jesus says, beware of this leaven, this doctrinal teaching that they have that removes you from the gospel and removes the gospel from you. It's not pure and it's not fine flour. It's something corrupt. Also, it brings to mind the sins of the traditionalism, intellectualism, and sensationalism, which is idolatry. See, the miracle was performed, but it took their eyes off of the ball, so to speak. They performed an incredible miracle. He's cleansing lepers. He's healing the sick. He's breaking bread to feed multitudes. And they're concentrating on that. He walked on water. And they missed the point. The gospel. Because of traditions. In fact, in last week, as in we were in Mark chapter 7, they were called hypocrites because Jesus said that you do blaspheme the word of God. Not observe the word of God, and you make the word of God, the commandment of God, of none effect by keeping your traditions. Traditionalism. Traditions aren't bad, but the traditionalism, in order to keep that and make it equal with the things of God, making it equal with the things of God is idolatry. See, remember that in days of old, in Isaiah, in chapter 1, when he's speaking of the idolatry of Isaiah, of Isaiah's day in the southern kingdom, they worshiped Jehovah God, but they had all these other gods too. In Ezekiel's day, when he receives a vision, Jeremiah's day, when he's talking about within the temple, before the temple is destroyed, these idols of the priests were in there. They worshiped God and did service unto him, but they had their idols in their back pockets, in the little closets, as Ezekiel was able to see through a vision through the wall. By the miracle of God. Intellectualism, we got to be aware of that, because God reveals unto us the parables, these things that bring to us spiritual truth that show the gospel of Jesus Christ, the incarnate God who became a man and lived a righteous life because we can't, and went to the cross as a sufficient sacrifice, a perfect sacrifice, shedding his blood for the forgiveness of sins, receiving in his person the wrath of God, paying a debt he did not owe for a debt that we owe but could not possibly pay, offering himself a sacrifice, his soul an offering before the Father. What a Father's Day gift that is. And yet, as he reveals this to us, we will exalt what we know. That's intellectualism. Instead of the gospel of God in the grace of Jesus Christ that is given to me freely because I deserve the hell of all torment of the sins that I committed against God. And then sensationalism of rushing off to the miracles rather than the miracles that are to point to the great spiritual truths of the Messiah. We seek the cure, but we forget the Christ. We seek all those jubilations and miracles, but we forget Jesus, the Son of God. And I might even add, sentimentalism. Because the Word of God is here, and even though it's not revealed to my soul, there are others whose souls have not had certain truths, like the doctrines of grace revealed unto them, and they tie into sentimentalism. Oh, God wouldn't do that. And they forsake the Word of God. They forsake a just God. Oh, God's a God of love. And so they get into sentimentalism rather than the truth of the Savior and the sanctified one. And so there are then also the sins of blasphemy, which is uncleanness. And that's when earlier in Mark chapter 2, when they were saying that Jesus cast out demons by the Beelzebub. So here are those things that are represented. Take heed, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. Don't you understand? All those things are to bring you along. You've been walking with me now so that you can hear these other truths, these great truths. Now verses 22 to 26, and it says, he cometh to Bethsaida, and they bring a blind man unto him, and he besought him to touch him. And he took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the town. And when he had spit on his eyes and put his hands upon him, he asked him if he saw aught. And he looked up and said, I see men as trees walking. After that, he put his hands again upon his eyes and made him look up. And he saw, and he was restored and saw every man clearly. And he sent him away to his house, saying, neither go into the town nor tell it to anyone in the town. Jesus does a very strange thing here, and this is one of the episodes that give a lot of folks trouble, because he spits in a person's eye. And an interesting thing, and I'm not going to belabor this one, but you know, in the Middle East, spitting is a sign of an insult. You spit on the ground because you're displeased, and or you are offended with someone, so you spit, or they're offended with you, so they spit. And spitting is that way now in the Middle East, and it was that way then in the Middle East. Spitting before somebody is an offensive thing in the East, in the Far East, all the way to the Middle East. It's an offensive thing. And interestingly, I would tie this in, and I'm kind of going out of my bounds here because I can't find commentators to truly agree with me on much of what I'm going to tell you right now, but I believe Jesus is just offended, not with the man itself, but in the blindness, because of what this blindness represents. They brought him unto him, and now he sees men like trees as he spits upon him. See, the man sees men as trees, and this is a pivotal point. Truth sees men as trees walking in the knowledge of good and evil, because in Genesis 3 and verse 6, when Adam's eyes were upon a tree, he became that tree in the sense that eating from the fruit and that fruit being in him, and he became the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He walked around as a tree, that which represented all things of disobedience against God. And men walked around as those kind of trees, as Matthew 4 and verses 1 through 11 present the three temptations that befell Eve in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 6. While they were standing at the tree in the middle of the garden, which Adam was told not to eat from. And in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 16, he sums it up with saying that these are the things that are not acceptable for before God the Father. In fact, I want to turn and read that verse, 1 John 2 and 16. And I pulled my place marker out, but that's all right. It says, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. On this Father's Day, may we take note that those things that are in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes and the pride of life are not of the Father, but are of the world. And those are the three things those are the three primary things where all other sins stem from. In what Jesus mentions, beware of the leaven, the sin of the Pharisees. They were filled with pride. They assumed and asserted themselves as righteous when there's only one righteous. Remember the rich young ruler that we had in the account from Mark. Good master, well, what must I do to have eternal life? And he says, why callest thou me good? There is only one good, that is God. They had pride, assuming that they were good as God. They had idolatry because they wanted their way. They wanted to keep the traditions of the washing of their hands. And many of them were unclean, blaspheming Christ and the miracles that he performed, saying that they were performed of the devil. The truth sees men as trees walking in the knowledge of good and evil. This man is a pivotal point in this gospel scenario. He looks back upon what Jesus says, and here is the sin of the Pharisees. He sees them as trees, but now Jesus touches him again, and his eyes are open. See, hope sees men as trees walking in the knowledge of good and evil. If I don't see myself as adulterous or unclean, if I don't see myself as idolatrous, as one that will lift up something in place of Jesus Christ, if I don't see myself as haughty and full of pride, if I don't see men walking as trees that are sinful because of Adam's disobedience, then I will not be able to have sight to see the Christ that is in my presence. He must touch me. He became a man. His humanity. Notice that in the book of Mark, especially, when he comes to healing people, he touches them. Why? Because John tells us in 1 John chapter 1 that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and our hands have handled of the word of life. Jesus became a man. God became a man and touched us for healing. Because it's in His humanity as a perfect man that would go to that cross. Righteous. And touch our infirmities, as it says in Isaiah 53. He touches our infirmities and cleanses them because of His imputed sacrifice. We hope sees men as trees. I must see myself as sinful. I must see other men as sinful and with no hope save in Jesus Christ alone. And His presence to touch each one of us. The two touches are to allow us to see something in the spiritual realm so that we can understand that there must be a recognition of sinfulness in the presence of Jesus Christ. And now we can be healed. Men who do not acknowledge their sin are lost and steeped in it. Behold the cross of Christ in verses 27 through 38 to the end. The last part and the important part that sums it up as the turning point of the Gospel of Mark, but also the turning point in this segment, in this chapter. Chapter 8 and verse 27. It says, and Jesus went out and His disciples into the towns of Caesarea Philippi. And by the way, He asked His disciples, saying unto them, whom do men say that I am? And we're going to have a devotion. I already wrote the devotion up last week while I was preparing this message. The Lord was good to me. We'll have that on Wednesday. We're going to look at some very interesting things in this portion. In verse 28, and they answered, John the Baptist, but some say Elias, and others one of the prophets. And He saith unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Peter answereth and said unto Him, thou art the Christ. And verse 30, and He charged them that they should tell no man of Him. And He began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and of the chief priests and the scribes and be killed. And after 3 days rise again. He's telling them the gospel. He's been giving them all His credentials of who He is up to this point, and now He tells them straight out, this is why He came. He came to preach, but what was this Christ preaching? He's preaching the Sermon on the Mount, and within that, the spiritual truths of Christ who came to redeem the world through His suffering upon the cross. And here it is. And He spake that saying openly, and Peter took Him and began to rebuke Him. And notice that this is very condensed. It's not like in Matthew, and we're not going to go there because we want to see these other things. But verse 33, but when He had turned about and looked on His disciples, He rebuked Peter, saying, get thee behind me, Satan, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men. And when He had called the people unto Him with His disciples, He said unto them, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. There, first time in the Gospel of Mark that He has mentioned the cross. And follow me, and it's in reference to this portion right here, and also in His speaking it, His first speaking it is in reference to us following Him by the cross. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake, and the gospels of the same shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. In this we see in verses 27 to 30, who is Jesus? That's the question that must come to every man. That if we are to be those who recognize our sinfulness as a man who was made, who is blind, who is made to see, who see men walking around as trees, and now receive our sight, we're in the presence of Jesus. And so the question comes, who is this Jesus? A lot of people have a lot of different things, and that's just as true today. And Peter comes up with the great and blessed truth. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And he charged no man to tell him. Just like he charged the blind man. He said, neither go, in verse 26, neither go into the town nor tell it to any in the town. One person he did say, go publish it. You know, remember the demoniac. He said, go tell them, because the episode was speaking on something else in its whole. But in the overall, see, there's exceptions, but in the overall, Jesus Christ had not yet gone to the cross. The Holy Spirit had not yet been given. They needed power to go forth. And except in those occasions when Jesus sent forth the 12 and sent forth the 70, they weren't empowered to preach the gospel. Christ. The truth of Christ must come by the Holy Spirit, as we read today, as Jimmy read in the devotion today in Romans chapter 8, praise God. I didn't know he was going to read in that, but that's where it says, if any man hath not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. It said in Romans chapter 8. So who is Christ? Comes by the truth of the Holy Spirit. What has he done? What has Christ done? Jesus says so, and I want to read it again. And he began to teach them at this point that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and of the chief priests and scribes and killed, and after 3 days rise again, Christ and him crucified. This is what Christ has done. This is what he is. He at this point he will do. But 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 20 tells us that he is the Lamb slain from before the foundation of the earth. So this is an eternal truth. It's already done. It's being carried out in this space-time continuum. Verses 31 to 33 present unto us what he has done, and that is a needful truth. We must know who he is. We must know what Christ has done. And then, see, the angels know what Christ is doing and they know what he has done. The fallen angels know what he is doing and they know what he has done, but they are not saved, as James tells us in James 2 and 19. You believe in one God, you do well. The devils believe and tremble. Because there must be a response. See, after the truth of the cross is so critical, because what was Peter's response? He rebuked him. Oh, Christ, Lord Christ, we love you. You have the words of eternal life, he says in John 6, after the feeding of the multitudes, and then the next day, and they all departed. Where would we go? You have the words of life. Call me out from the boat. That's not in Mark, but remember, Jesus walked on the water. Call me out from the boat. I will walk with you. This is a man who is sincere. But he's not sincere of spiritual things. He needs that Holy Spirit. He needs Christ to go to the cross. He needs to have it happen. And so what does he do? Anything that denies the cross of Christ is antichrist. Anything that denies Christ's sufferings will be that which condemns and receive a rebuke as a rebuke unto Satan himself. Get thee behind me, Satan, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men. And I hate when that passage of Scripture is quoted for the tiniest little infractions of the law. People quote it for just, get thee behind me, Satan, because somebody is offended, a wife or a sibling is acted out of sorts, and they, get thee behind me, Satan. I hate that. Why? Because this was used for the cross of Christ, which is the most incredible truth and the most central truth of all the universe. It is used to show the importance of Christ going to the cross and his blood being shed for the forgiveness of sins. And therefore, then we can respond, because without the cross, without the Christ, who he is and what he has done, responding to take up my cross and denying self to follow him is useless, because it's only superficial works at best. It is not empowered by the Spirit, and it is not cleansed by the blood, and it is not appeasing and pleasing and a propitiation before the Father. And so that is a rebuke itself. Because when it says in verses 34, we must respond, verses 34, I have it 33 to 38. It's 34 to 38. There must be a response, and let's conclude it. Concluding applications, and Wednesday I urge you, if you can come out for a prayer meeting, our devotion will be in that section of whom do men say that I am. I think it's a great devotional. It'll take some more time than we have today, but it'll really round some things up, so I encourage you to come out for that. What are our conclusions and applications? Saving faith reveals men as trees in Christ's presence. And it must be that. There must be that touch of the Lord. He must come and He must reveal unto us. We cannot just merely acknowledge our sins and walk away. He sees men as trees, but we know that the presence of Christ is there and His hand is upon him. The offense of sinfulness is such that blind eyes that do not see the gospel can only be spit upon. And so, saving faith reveals men as trees, and that all these other things that are supposed to point to Christ can end up becoming unclean or idolatry or full of pride apart from the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I may be fed today and filled with great things and clothed and have a house and be provided for materially, but if it does not honor God through Christ who gave His life for us, then it's nothing. Next, saving faith relies upon the truth of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. It must trust upon Him, hurl ourselves upon Him, that when He speaks, and He speaks things that I don't understand, like Peter had no understanding of that. He's teaching on the cross, and though hints are given all throughout, unless Christ reveals it by the Spirit, he wouldn't know it, and He rebukes him. It requires a trust, and it requires a trust that the truth of what God has done upon the cross, and that Jesus Christ is He whom He said He was, and whom the Word says He is, whom prophets preach with imperfect lips about, but that God, the power of God, the Holy Spirit, though men are sinful and fallen, that that power comes forth to reveal the Son of God, alive, risen, crucified, risen, and ascended in our lives to come again in power and glory. So saving faith responds according to that the truth of these things. We must respond in saving faith. How can I take up my cross and follow Him? It's the truth of Christ's cross that becomes my eternal possession. And what it is that I must know what men are. Jesus, in John chapter 2, there's a comment that says that Jesus didn't give Himself over unto men because He knew all men. Jesus knew who men were. He's the creator of them. But we also, if we are to be as Christ and conform to His image, we must know what men are. And therefore, we can forgive. Why? Because if they are sinners, what will they do? They will sin. They will offend me. And they will offend God. But I have not the power to forgive their sins or atone for them. But I can give them the temporal forgiveness that comes from me, knowing that they can do no better except by the grace of God. And there, but by the grace of God, go I. I would sin even as they. What men are. And who Jesus is. The truth of the gospel knows who Jesus is and relishes on the truth of who Jesus is and desires the truth of who Jesus is and wants nothing more than to glorify these truths that come from the Word of who Jesus is. And what Jesus has done, we do not shirk. We do not shy away. We do not shrink from the truth of what Christ has done. The cross is a stumbling block for sure, but if Christ has done a work, then we're not ashamed. For hope maketh not ashamed, for the Holy Spirit because the love of God that is shed abroad in our hearts is by the Holy Spirit given us. Hope maketh not ashamed. But if we are ashamed then of what He has done, then maybe He hasn't done that work, and we should call out upon Him. And what Christ commands, saving faith responds according to the truth of what Christ commands, what men are in Christ. It starts out with what men are apart from Christ, what sinful men are. And it ends with saving faith recognizes what men are in Christ. That they are those who are enabled and equipped and have that truth walking with them, that they may take up the cross. Deny self, take up the cross, and follow Him. Let us go before the Lord in prayer. Most blessed and heaven and gracious Heavenly Father, only by Thy Spirit may this truth go forth into hearts, and I pray that it does. Because I have, in one sense, I can say that I've slaughtered Your Word, it has not come forth in the manner that it probably that it could have been capable of coming forth from. But you have used the not many mighty, not many noble, not the wise of this world, but the foolish things of these world of this world to confound the wise. We pray, Father, that it be by the power of your Holy Spirit, and that therefore this earthen vessel will not receive any glory from it. And I pray that our lives will not be the same, everyone here. And if there is someone who does not know Jesus Christ in this way, that we might, that your Spirit may save them utterly and totally. We love you, Lord, and thank you. In Jesus' holy, precious, and mighty name, amen.